You see this? When I found it on the floor of a local trade-in store, it had this stuck to it with packing tape. When these first came out as a bundle, they cost $100. $120 if you got the Rye bundle. I got them for $3. Together. And I thought that would be enough. But then I wondered, would it be entirely fair to cover the second Tony Hawk board peripheral game without covering the first? So I got Ride as well, off of Amazon, new, for $1. Apparently by the time that Shred came out, my local trade-in stores stopped accepting the games and the board because they were just getting traded in so much. So, two games, one chunk of plastic, still somehow under $5. Welcome to $5 gaming.
How much do I like the Tony Hawk games? About this much. However, after a while I stopped following the series as religiously as I had in the early days. This was around the time that games like Downhill Jam were being developed by non-Neversoft entities, and Neversoft themselves were on the way out of the Tony Hawk games so they could move on to bigger and better things, like running Guitar Hero into the ground.
Then something came along that the Tony Hawk games hadn't seen very often during its long run. Strong competition. In this case, in the form of Skate from Electronic Arts.
Skate, despite being a new IP with its own laundry list of problems to deal with, would outsell Tony Hawk's Proving Ground in 2007. Meanwhile, Activision, along with the newly formed Robomoto, decided that instead of competing directly with the Skate series, they'd go after a different audience by creating a plastic board peripheral in a time when plastic peripherals were commonplace for games like Guitar Hero, Rock Band, and Wii games that clearly didn't need them.
Because as anyone who's taken an economics class would know, the greatest ideas and innovations come not from competition, but a lack of competition. So you have less of a reason to ensure that you're creating the best product possible.
Activision influenced this decision by Robomoto, according to an anonymous former Robomoto employee, with marketing research and focus groups that showed Skate wasn't bringing in new fans, and the idea of a skateboard peripheral polled well.
Isn't this the same kind of market research and focus group bullshit that said The Witcher should be an MMORPG with a female elf as a protagonist?
And so, Tony Hawk Ride was born. And it wasn't just an instance of using his name because it was in the franchise title. Tony Hawk was involved, playtesting the game with the board, giving feedback to the developers, and eventually, white knighting for them on Twitter when the review scores came out.
Or at least the reviewers that bought the game when it came out. You see, Activision decided to invite all their reviewers to a Tony Hawk Ride launch party slash review party, instead of sending pre-release copies so that the reviewers could score the game on their own time. Guess which reviewers gave Tony Hawk Ride the best scores? And guess what the Metacritic score did for Tony Hawk Ride when the people who weren't at the review party sent in their scores?
I can't get into the game without first going over the chunk of plastic I had to get with it. There are two boards, one for Ride and one for Shred, though the only major difference between them is the graphic on top, and they each work for both Ride and Shred. Designed to be like the deck of a skateboard, it's about the same size as the average skateboard deck, and can support players up to 300 pounds. It also has all the face buttons of the controller and directional pad on the side of it, so that it can act as a full-on replacement of using a regular controller. However, using these side buttons feels really awkward, especially since I have to get off the board and pick it up to do this. The menus are also navigable by tilting the board from side to side and using ollies to select things. But that's even more awkward than the side controls. As such, I ended up playing a fair chunk of the game while holding a PS3 controller to sort through menus faster. The board syncs up with the system via a USB dongle. Or at least that's how it's supposed to work. You see, one of the more infamous parts of the game is simply being able to play it. The board had all kinds of problems trying to connect to the system, regardless of platform. which prompted people to try all sorts of things, ranging from logical to ridiculous, to be able to play the game at all.
See if you can tell which solutions I actually found on the internet, and which ones I'm just making up.
I got it.
For the record, holding the board up and desperately pressing buttons, aka the only solution that worked, were the ones that I made up.
The game starts with Tony Hawk guiding the player through board calibration, a 3-minute process in which even Tony struggles to kill time waiting for the actual game to start.
Hey, look over there. Alright, now look here. Okay. All finished. Try to keep the board still during this process. So, how's the weather? What do you guys do around there for fun?
Well, normally I play video games, but okay, we're not there yet. Finished. He goes on to mention that you should only have to recalibrate the board after changing boards or changing batteries in the board.
He's implying I'll play the game long enough for the batteries to die.
Ride has a few different modes of play. For multiplayer, there's online play, which good luck finding anyone to play against, even if you send them direct messages. And party mode, where two or more people select a difficulty, level, and skater, and play speed, getting to the end of a stage as fast as possible while hitting speed boosts or picking up time bonuses, trick session, the usual timed high score affair, spot challenge, doing certain tricks on certain lines, or skate competition, all played by taking turns using the board peripheral. Not much to say here other than I have an unusual urge to buy a T-Mobile Sidekick every time I navigate a menu or watch a cutscene. The beef of the game is in its single player, which consists of exhibition, or something resembling Free Skate, and Road Trip, which is like a single-player campaign. You can do the same challenges, races, and trick sessions in Exhibition as in Road Trip, but you won't get credit for completing any of them. Exhibition is made even more useless by Road Trip's having a Free Skate option for every stage.
So there's basically just one single-player mode, in which you are forced to play as a create-a-skater, kind of like Tony Hawk Underground or Tony Hawk American Wasteland. Because, you know, you're so much more into the game, where you have some vague caricature that kinda, sorta, maybe looks like you, which you can scream obscenities at when everything goes horribly wrong.
As you might expect, there are lots of skateboard decks, shirts, and shoes, more of which can be unlocked as the game goes on, and some of which might be quite familiar if you're into skateboarding. Aside from that, though, the game has horrifically misplaced priorities on what the skater can look like. There are more options for headphones than there are for hair. Hell, there are almost twice as many options for facial hair as there are for hair. Things like faces, body types, and skin tone are also limited to the point that Ride's creation suite is outclassed by games from earlier in the Tony Hawk series. Such as Pro Skater 3, a game that came out 8 years before Ride. Road Trip has 6 different cities with 4 different areas to do speed, trick, and challenge modes to raise up to 10 points on each mode and 30 points in each area. Except for the last one, with more points for things like skate competitions, adding up to 500 points for the overall campaign. These points add up to unlock new cities as well as additional areas in each city to earn more points in. All the while, other pro skaters appear, sometimes with weird film filters making them look like they're made of wax, to pretend they're interested in helping you along, trying and failing to be funny more often than me, or both.
I just had a chat with Tony Hawk. Ha! You may have heard of him.
Build up the meter by pumping up the crowd. Keep them pumped.
Dude, just pulling sick tricks isn't gonna be enough. Want the dude or no dude? Remember, combos are key. Gotta throw a dude in there. Dude.
And the first time you see them, a highlight video of their work plays. Remember how in old Tony Hawk games you had to unlock these videos and get some sense of accomplishment for doing it?
Screw that. Instant gratification is the way of the future. A miserable dystopian nightmare of a future, but the future nonetheless.
After completing a session, the game doesn't tell you how many points you've earned until you go through any gear unlocking messages, wait for the game to autosave, do a best score or time display, autosave again, play another cutscene of whatever pro skaters got roped into this game, back out to select a new mode, and then you can see how many points you've earned. I've witnessed drunken Chinese fire drills more organized than this, especially since the game sometimes locks up for a moment trying to go through the unlockables, or even just trying to save your game. And on a minor note, trick sessions can be pretty annoying to do if you reach the quote-unquote end of the stage before time runs out, especially since you can't use manuals or aerial tricks to keep going after the initial timer runs out like in other Tony Hawk games. In addition, each section also tends to have either a specific area for doing things like contests, vert competitions, or challenges against specific pros. The competitions in particular abandoned the medals and judge scoring system from before, and instead it just adds up all the points for each individual trick session. Simpler, yes, but it certainly doesn't feel like a competition anymore. These specialized areas tend to feel pretty samey and claustrophobic, but then again, so do some of the main levels. Almost every stage is designed like a straight line, due in part to both casual mode and the speed mode, though it does sometimes get swapped out for slalom mode, which isn't actually a slalom so much as collecting X amount of beacons as fast as possible. Overall, most of the stages feel quite bland and lacking, save for maybe Central Park, and not worth the nearly 30 seconds of load time between each stage, even if you're just switching between modes of play on the same stage, especially when exploration is cut down so much compared to the past Tony Hawk games. Even the Downhill Phoenix stage and New York Mall from the first Tony Hawk felt like they had more going for them. Sure, the first game's levels were mostly devoid of life, but having people in the background who are virtually statues unless they're getting out of the way, and they won't even do that sometimes, or occasionally pretending to cheer, is way worse for your levels than having no one there at all. Then again, I'm a bit surprised these NPCs managed not to slip into the same dimensional void that other parts of the environment did, like this trash bag, for example. Actually, they can do just the opposite, appearing out of nowhere from about 5 feet away. The soundtrack for this game certainly doesn't help matters either. A lot of it is inoffensive background noise, but the songs repeat way, way too often. Especially this one crappy cover of Blitzkrieg Bop that sounds more like Blitzkrieg Kids Bop. Hell, sometimes I find myself wishing that the music would behave like the sound in this game, and cut out at random times. Road Trip is also divided into three difficulties: Casual, Confident, and Hardcore. Casual is the mode most people that got this game likely played the most. It locks the skater into following a set path, removing any steering aside from leaning to select a path at certain points, and just letting the player do stunts wherever the line happens to take them. It's the skateboarding equivalent of a rail shooter. Hardcore gives the player complete control, where steering is completely unrestricted and the player can go anywhere, for better or worse. Confident, despite being the equivalent of normal, might actually be the worst difficulty in the game. Confident gives the player partial control over steering, but also tries to guide the player on where to go. The end result is that the steering is incredibly stiff and sometimes unresponsive, and the game ultimately guides the player into walls more than wherever they're supposed to go.
Whoa, what?
This is only made worse by not having an effective way to stop or slow down. Anyway, Road Trip starts with a bit of foreshadowing.
Can you believe it? This skater just turned pro, and now look where we're at. This is a true Cinderella story. Just a few days ago, they were called up by P-Rod for a special mission in Southern California.
Should you be caught, killed, or suffer any foot injuries, the secretary will disavow any wrongdoing and blame you for not playing the game right? This mission sucks.
Tony Hawk then guides the player through how to use the board and do basic things like push and turn, then sets you on a casual run of the first stage. Amazingly enough, he doesn't explain how to do any tricks or even how to ollie until after this run, where you're supposed to just do whatever. Grinding is about as simple as it can get in Ride, since you'll automatically start grinding any surface you ollie and land on, and can then change which grind you're doing by moving the board around in the middle of it. Just make sure there's carpet wherever you're doing this, or your floor may get wrecked by the bottom of the board. Your skater can't lose balance in this game, and the worst that will happen is you try grinding up an incline and come to a stop, at which point your skater bails, goes limp, and then respawns elsewhere. As easy as grinding is, it still doesn't work properly at times, since ledge and rail detection can be pretty suspect at times. Grabs are done by sticking your hand over the sensors on the front, back, and front side of the board. If you manage to get these to work on a consistent basis, congratulations, you're one step ahead of where I was when I played through Ride. Tony also explains how to do tilt and flick tricks. Tilt tricks involve doing an ollie or an ollie, then tilting the board to either side. These are typically things like regular kick flips and heel flips. Flick tricks are done by ollieing or nollieing and then rotating the board to either side. These include a variety of things, such as 360 kick or heel flips, hospital flips, or anything you'd typically trigger in the old Tony Hawk games by hitting the flip trick button and holding a diagonal direction.
And now you know the difference between tilt tricks and flip tricks, which puts you one step ahead of the game.
One major problem with Ride is the way the game reads motions of the board, particularly when it comes to differentiating different motions. In particular, the game has a very hard time telling apart tilt tricks and flick tricks. This may not matter as much for the speed sections or some trick attack areas, but there are several challenges on each stage which specify what type of trick to do in certain spots. End up doing the wrong trick? Oh well. Then again, that does assume parts of the challenge won't just fail for no apparent reason. The same problem exists for manuals and ollies. I lost count of how many times I ended up doing a manual when I wanted to ollie. Hell, sometimes it wouldn't read anything at all. It wasn't even a board calibration problem, although I did have to recalibrate 2 times trying to finish the game, and sometimes I would just retry and the game behaved normally again. Unbelievably, there are also times where the game can't differentiate between doing a manual and doing nothing. And to frustrate the player a little bit more, challenges don't reset if you fail an objective at any point before the end of it. There's no partial credit, so there's no reason to keep going with it and try to finish everything else. Try to go out of bounds or crash into something instead, because those are some of the only ways to reset the challenge.
Speaking of going out of bounds and crashing,
given the way the game controls outside of casual mode, the learning curve for doing, well, anything is especially high. On top of having a slight delay on everything the skater does, this also means constantly crashing into walls, obstacles, or even just falling off the board for no apparent reason, putting the game's ragdoll physics on prominent display, which are somehow worse than some Bethesda games that came out a few years earlier. There is, however, another side effect of losing control of your skater, which is increasing the chance that something like this will happen.
What? Huh?
In all the Tony Hawk games I've played, I have never managed to accidentally go out of bounds as often as I have in Tony Hawk Ride. And the sad thing is, going out of bounds is only the beginning of the weird shit that can happen in this game.
Why is the protection on those so... What? What? No! I'm done! What?! What?! Oh no, no! Where am I?! Where am I?! Whoa! What? I'm out of bounds! Holy shit! Whoa! Oh god!
Beyond that, the game also performs terribly in certain levels, with the frame rate dropping into single digits and slowing down for seemingly no reason. And then the game compounds the problem by locking the camera out of position.
Hey. Where? Oh, what happened? Where am I going? What happened to the camera, guys? Where am I? Thank you!
Actually, the camera is yet another major issue, especially on challenges or sessions when it positions itself underneath or inside objects, or otherwise blocks your view.
Where? What? What? What?!
This happens a lot when trying to pull off special signature moves, as the camera flings itself to the side so you can't see what's coming in front of you. The one time the game really seems to perform almost as intended is during vert sections. You reposition the board so it's parallel to the screen, and skate back and forth in a small, enclosed halfpipe, where the only serious danger most of the time is launching yourself into the crowd. The controls alter slightly so you can do rotations easier. And by easier, I mean I never crashed doing any tricks or rotations, regardless of how late they were performed. It's also easier to pull off a bunch of special tricks when the style meter fills up. But then there are times where the game asks you to do things it never explained how to do. Some challenges include doing things like spine transfers, which I just guessed how to do, and grinding a rail or ledge and then jumping to a specific side, which, again, I had to figure out how to do on my own. Manual finger flips? I also just figured those out on my own. Add all of this in with some incredibly repetitive, if not always functional gameplay, jumping from speed to trick to challenge modes in nearly every section of every city, not getting even basic maneuvers to register properly far into the game, or even having the board disconnect for no apparent reason, and this is the most pissed off I've been at a video game in decades.
Ollie! What was the camera doing? Look how hard I am leaning left and right, and he is not doing anything. Do the fucking grab! You piece of shit!
Anyway, later in the game, unique challenges start to open up with or against specific pros, such as the manual challenge, where you have to beat a high score using just flat ground tricks, or playing a game of skate against Nyjah Houston. This is like Horse, but with a very small selection of skateboard tricks. And again, it's an instance where you can get screwed over by the game mixing up tilt and flick tricks. Though, it's tough for that to happen when the game asks you to perform such amazing tricks as an ollie. Fortunately, in-game Nyjah Houston is a terrible skater, as he regularly does the wrong trick, or tries performing tricks a couple inches off the ground before ragdolling himself into the concrete.
I can't believe you beat me!
I can't believe that your acting is worse than your in-game character's skating.
The one time this game really seems to cut loose and have some good old crazy Tony Hawk-style fun is in the final city, Tokyo, when Tony Hawk puts you through the Boom X2 vertical U-ramp.
For 2 years, I've kept people in the dark about where I was and what I've been working on. I've had you cross the globe and learn from the best, all for this moment. As my student, you have one more challenge. A series of trials that test the mettle of a true skater. The Boom X2 TH Vertical U-Ramp, go! Drop in and let's see if you can handle my world. Now go!
Here your score gets multiplied by getting big air on the pipes and lighting up X number of lights, or by collecting bonus balls earned by performing tricks that match the icons on the quarter pipes, each being worth 10,000 points, which can also then be multiplied. The end result is that you can easily rack up scores in the tens of millions, combining bonus balls with big air multipliers and signature moves. It's a legitimately fun area to play.
You didn't think this was the ending, did you?
Thinking, hoping, praying, whatever word you want to use.
Yes! Get ready for the ultimate skate session.
Well, it's not over, because there's still the Boom X2 TH Go Show. Fitting how the only stages of the final city are the best stage in the game, and the worst stage in the game. The final stage is supposed to be built like some bizarre Japanese game show. The Go Show is one long downhill race through a series of obstacles with a 3-minute 30-second time limit. Most of it is just trying to skate over, through, or around various Japanese-themed levels or sound stages. But it starts off with 3 rounds of rock, paper, scissors, where you need to steer through the right image. You gain time by picking up time bonuses, just like in the speed sections, and also for doing things like smashing targets, unless the game decides you're not worthy and you just pass right through the damn thing. Even so, the final level is ultimately one long struggle against the controls. There's a section where you need to jump across grind rails, a section where you make a completely blind drop to a quarter pipe you can't see until you've already missed it. But all of that pales in comparison to riding along the back of this narrow-ass dragon, all while the game spontaneously lags trying to display all the smoke and moving objects in the background. Although that's not to say it doesn't slow down everywhere else, too.
The whole world is watching! No pressure.
All right, Tony. You want to be like that? Now I'm gonna beat this goddamn game purely out of spite!
Jump, you piece of shit! Fuck you. Fuck you and everything you stand for. Go! Go! You went through the... Fuck you! Oh, right! Right! Oh, you sack of shit!
After trying over and over to get through this, I resorted to doing the one thing that sort of worked when I couldn't get the controls to work while standing on the board. I stepped off and moved the board with my hands. At this point, I should just be using a regular controller. But after several dozen falls and being on the verge of rage quitting, this happened.
You made it! Great job! You are officially the newest skater to join the elite crew of Boom X2 TH Go Show winners. It's been a long journey, but you showed that we made the right choice. Congrats, and I'll see you in the next episode of Boom X2 TH Go Show! Hey, this is Tony again. I hope you had fun playing Tony Hawk Ride. Here are the people who made this game happen.
Thank you for playing. Now here's a hit list in case you feel like going Agent 47 on our asses.
I can't... I just... how did they take an admittedly kind of awesome idea and have this as the final product? Top Skater, an arcade game from 1997 with a similar board input method, legitimately controls far better than this. The board peripheral takes a frustrating, monotonous game and turns it into a frustrating, monotonous, physically exhausting game. What's really sad, though, is that this is by far the most recent game to show up on $5 gaming, and it's here despite having to get the game and a special controller for it. I hate to say it, Mr. Hawk. I love your game series, I like some of your clothes, and hell, I'm wearing Hawk brand shoes right now. But Tony Hawk Ride isn't worth the time, effort, or money I put into it.
There! Finally! I'm gonna chuck this game in the closet and bury it under all the other things I'm trying to forget I own. What? What are you Oh, no. No. I can't do Shred now, after all I just went through. No. Screw it. I need a break. I'm going out. You know what? I'll be at the park, guys. Later.